I thank the A.K. Dasgupta Center for Planning and Development of Vishwabharati for inviting me in this August task of planning, managing, and developing human resources. I'll be sharing the screen with you all now. Hope it is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
I'll not be able to see the chat box since I've gone on this mode. So if anyone has any questions, kindly stop me and you can ask, okay, whenever you have any queries. As you all understand that since we have a mixed group of students, research scholars, and faculty members, I have to strike a balance in the level that I'm going to follow. So we'll start with the very basics and then we will try to move up. And since I've got a corporate experience and, we deal with training. So after the theoretical aspect is over, I'll try to give you a live example of, one of the training programs that we have conducted and how we actually try to use whatever theoretical knowledge that we gain in the practical aspect also. So I'd like to start the session now. Now, Thomas J. Watson, the founder of IBM, he had said that you can get capital and erect building, but it takes people to build a business. Now, people or human resources provides that competitive edge or advantage to a business. And it is more or less the most important factor in deciding the fate of an organization if they have the same amount of capital and machinery. So it is the manpower who decides who is going to be the leader and who is going to be the follower. Now, our topic over the next two sessions, there are three distinct words are there: human, resource, and development. So let us try to understand what each of these words denote. When we talk about resource, as you all know, it is typically defined as something that a country can use to increase its wealth. Now, organizations have physical wealth or resources like building, they have machinery. For example, we have manufacturing facilities. Organizations have financial resources like capital, earning, equity, and they also have the human resources, that is the manpower of the organization who can drive the performance of the organization. Development is the process by which the human resources of an organization, they are prepared to handle future responsibilities and tackle the challenges of changes. It can be something like a new technology that is there. It can be the cultural diversity that an organization has in its manpower. It can be increase in the knowledge workers who are more difficult to handle than those who are working at the shop floor. Or it can be, even the unprecedented changes or challenges that are thrown to us by the COVID-19. Now, this urge to tide over the challenging times, to adapt ourselves to the changing environment, to learn new skills and technology, to deliver in this new normal that we are talking about, this is the greatest triumph of human resource development. So overall, human resource development is that manpower resource that any organization has, who by adapting themselves to the changing environment that we have, we can actually use this resource in increasing the productivity of any organization and be an efficient organization in the long run. Today, we will be covering the concept, the different HRD interventions which are there, and the individual development. tomorrow morning we have a session from 10 a.m. 10:30 a.m. So there we will be talking about the team development and the HRD evaluation. Now, we all are aware of the term training. Now, this is something which we have been, using very colloquially, that, I'm going for a training program. Now, HRD is often considered as synonymous with training and development. So let us now see how the concept of HRD has evolved over time. The origins of HRD, it can be traced to the apprenticeship training programs in the 18th century. Now, these were the times when, we had small little shops which were operated by skilled artisans, and they produced small household goods like, say, furniture, clothes, shoes. Slowly they found that, there was a growing demand for their products, and the artisans themselves could not actually meet the demand. So what they did, they started employing certain additional workers who were unskilled, untrained. These artisans educated them and trained them, and they learned, how to do this job and started helping their masters. Now, once they became very proficient in this trade, they themselves moved out of the artisans and they started their own shops independently. This concept of apprenticeship training program is still available today. When we find this in our jobs, like, that of the doctors when they are doing their housetopship, in the attorneys, in the chartered accountants. So this apprenticeship training program of helping or learning from their seniors is still continued even today. The next major step in the HRD movement was that of the early vocational educational programs. Now the first recorded one that we have is 1809, where DeWitt Clinton, he founded the first recognized privately funded vocational school. And these are also known as manual schools in New York City. The purpose was that, people who had certain criminal background and they were unemployed. So to provide certain occupational training to these young people who could be brought back to the society. We also have the first act, the Smith-Hughes Act, in 1917. This act recognized the value of vocational education by granting funds which were targeted for state programs in agricultural trades, home economics, industry, and teachers training. Now you will find that, this concept of vocational training has yet again become very, very important in our current scenario, where vocational education is actually becoming a very prime factor in our education or the changing education system that we all are having. Early factory schools was the next development that we have. Now, we had the Industrial Revolution in the late 1800s, and this brought about a major change. So major change in the sense that, the machine started replacing the hand tools, and along with it, the requirement for unskilled workers actually started diminishing. There was more and more need for trained workers to design, build, and repair machines which were used by unskilled workers. Now factories increased. A number of them increased, and with it, the demand for the skilled workers also increased, and the vocational training schools could not provide the adequate number of skilled workers which were required. So in order to meet this demand, the factories started creating mechanical and machinist training programs, which are known as the factory schools. These factory schools were not the same as the apprenticeship training program. They were different because they were shorter in duration. Their focus was very narrow because they just focused on imparting that skill which was required to do a particular job. Beyond that, the factory schools did not actually try to teach anything more. It was only limited to whatever is required to do the job. We find a few documented factory schools like General Electric and Baldwin Locomotive, International Harvester, Ho and Company. A few of them were there. Now, this actually we find that early training programs for semi-skilled and unskilled workers came up. Now, this was again, a major change was the mass production of the Model T, which was brought out by Ford in 1913. Now, why this was created a furor? Because it was the first mass-produced car using an assembly line, and in which production required only the training of the semi-skilled workers to perform several tasks. Now, the demand for Model T was huge because production cost was lowered, prices were decreased, and demand was huge. So this necessitated more and more assembly lines, and this provided for more training opportunities. During this time, we also find that meet the demand for the military equipment during the First World War, there were many factories which were producing non-military goods. These factories had to retool their machinery and retrain their workers. So the concept of retraining of workers also came in at this time, because they were trained to produce non-military goods, and World War I required military items to be produced. Hence, there was a requirement for changeover of the skill that was required to produce such items. Whenever we have, the factory system come up, so along with the factory system, what comes is the abuse or the exploitation of the unskilled workers. They had unhealthy working conditions, long hours, low pay. So a lot of, anti-factory campaign started, and this was the human relations movement. They advocated that, a better human working condition should be there. And it was considered that, people should not be considered as a material. It was not a cog in the factory machine. Because whenever we talk of the fact of the Industrial Revolution, you find that we have the image of a wheel. So it was said that, man cannot be a cog in that wheel of the factory. So it is, we have to consider that the workers are people, and they are required to be behaved or given better owners. So they highlighted the importance of human behavior, and that the behavioral science applications also came up. Why we are talking about this aspect is that so far we were talking only about skills required to do a job. What human relations movement did was they brought in the focus on the behavioral aspect also. We also have during this time Abraham Maslow's famous needs theory. And this needs theory, it reinforced the notion that there are varied needs that the human being has, and that the desires of the workers were important sources of motivation in the workplace. And without that motivation, you really cannot force somebody to work and increase the productivity of the organization. World War II came in next. And this again necessitated the retooling of the factories to boost the war efforts, leading to the establishment of, the new training programs. The concept of training within industry, or TWI, came up at this time. Now, the training within industry, it was, done so that, all the training programs across the defense related industries could be coordinated. So TWI means that you are getting training to handle this retooling, and then all the defense related industries would actually be put together, and then the training programs can be coordinated within them. It also trained the instructors who were there to teach their programs at each plant. So we have a localized level of training also, that retraining, like once the trainers got trained, they came back and they trained the other workers in the each of these plants. These defense-related companies, they established their own training department with instructors who were trained by this TWI. Now, they coordinated training across all the organizations. And in 1942, we find that the first society, American Society for Training Directors, ASTD, was formed to establish some standards within this emerging profession. Thereafter, we find that HRD evolved when in the 1960s and the 1970s, the professional trainers, they realized that their role was beyond the classroom. Training and development competencies, started including interpersonal skill development, coaching, group process facilitation, problem solving. And this emphasis on entire employee development, this forced ASTD to rename itself. And from the American Society for Training Directors, it renamed itself to the American Society for Training and Development. ASTD approved the term HRD so that, the concept of growth, of change, those could be incorporated into their entire corpus. And the 1990s efforts were made to strengthen the strategic role of HRD, that is how HRD links to and supports the goals and objectives of the organization. In India, what we have is that in the early 1970s, Professor Uday Parekh and T.V. Rao of IIM, they were approached by L&T for a review exercise of their performance appraisal system. In 1974, certain recommendations were made by them for improving the system. The recommendation included development-oriented performance appraisal system, that it may not achieve its objective unless certain subsystems like employee counseling, potential appraisal, career planning and development, training, OD, etc., were also incorporated into this system. So L&T accepted these changes, and in 1975, the new HRD system was introduced in L&T. This was the first of its kind in India, and it clearly established the link between the various personnel related aspects such as performance appraisal, employee counseling, potential appraisal, training, etc. Now, today, most of the larger private and public sector organizations in India, they use the techniques and approaches of HRD so that they can develop their workforce in such a manner that the organizational goals are actually achieved along with the individual's satisfaction and growth. In this is called the human resource wheel, and the concept that I was just talking about during the evolution, this was clearly stated in this wheel that we are having. Pitt McLagan, he developed this HR wheel, and it clearly demarcates the scope of HRD. As you can see in the diagram itself, that the HRD areas are training and development, organizational development, career development, and its related areas are organizational or job design, human resource planning, performance management system, selection and staffing. Now, we see that HRD's scope, it's not limited to only training and development. It is definitely much wider than the training and development, though sometimes we do consider it as synonymous to training. Now, training and development deals with acquiring the knowledge and skill to handle a current job. Development, on the other hand, is futuristic and it prepares the human resources for future responsibilities. Now, the objective is that the human efficiency should be increased, and which is likely to affect the productivity of the organization in the positive way. Organizational development is, on the other hand, a process used to achieve organizational goals and objectives by ensuring overall satisfaction of the employees towards his or her job with use of structured activities. Now, these activities are implemented by certain change agents who come over to bring about a positive change, and it tries to improve the organizational health so that the employees will be happy, and then they will work towards increasing or enhancing the organizational effectiveness. Career development is the process by which individuals are prepared or developed in such a manner so that they can move up in their career path. As you all can understand, that this is also futuristic, and people are being trained so that, you know, they can grow up in the organizational hierarchy. So from these three, now we come to the definition of HRD. This definition has been coined by T.V. Rao. As I have said, that he is one of the proponents of the HRD concept in India. And the key words in the definition of HRD that we find, that it is a process by which the employees of an organization are helped in a planned and continuous way. That is, to have effective HRD, the interventions which are designed, they must be planned properly and implemented continuously. It cannot be done half-hearted or whimsical effort at showing to the management that, you know, the training budget has been exhausted. By definition, the HRD efforts should develop the capabilities of each employee as an individual, such that he can discharge his present role and be prepared for future roles. HRD also emphasizes on having a sound relationship between the employee and the supervisor. It also considers team spirit and collaboration among different units of the organization as a very important part. And I repeat myself that HRD should actually have certain training interventions, which is going to promote this process in a continuous way. Now, for HRD to be effective, organizations must create an environment which will be conducive for development. We can have, you know, a number of interventions, we can plan them, but without this climate that we are talking about, it will never be successful. In this developmental climate that we are talking about, human resource must be treated as the most important resource. Every manager must consider that developing his junior is his job, and believe that everybody can change and learn at any stage of life. It may happen that, you know, some people do take time when they age. The manner in which they can rapidly, you know, accept the changes when they are younger, it's definitely not possible when people age. It takes more time for them to adapt to the changes or to remember each of the steps which are there. For example, you give a mobile to a child, the manner in which he'll get adapted to it will not be the same when you give it to an elderly person, your grandmother or somebody elderly in the family. So we can understand that, you know, it is difficult, but it is not impossible at any stage. So HRD, the same here, we cannot just say that, you know, write off an employee because he or she has become elderly in the organization. So the work environment, it must also encourage free communication, risk taking, experimentation, trust, collaboration, team spirit, and mechanism for self-awareness of strengths and weaknesses. So each and every individual must be catered to whenever we are talking about an organization which has got conducive HRD climate. The other concept that we have of a positive HRD climate is to have an Octapec culture. Now the terminology Octapec, the acronym that we use, O stands for openness, confrontation, trust, autonomy, proactivity, authenticity, and collaboration. Now, if you look at these qualities that we are talking about, we find that, you know, when we are talking in terms of openness, that is, we are saying that there will be an open channel of communication where employees will not be dictated upon. Anything, any suggestions that they have, they can freely talk about it. They can talk about, you know, anything wrong happens, they can open up and then can they can talk about it. The positive aspect of openness is that if you try to force anybody to contain their feelings, then what happens is that we get a pressure cooker effect when all of a sudden it can actually burst if you keep something pressed hard for a very, very long time. Confrontation is often considered as a negative quality, but you know, when you have people confront somebody, then what happens is that, you know, at a stage when it has not gone out of control, you can bring out the problems and the issues into the open and try to solve them. You know, if you again try to resolve something when the fire has broken out, it is always better to find out the source from where, you know, a fire can erupt and take necessary measures that everything does not get engulfed in the fire if it breaks up someday. Next, we have trust. Trust means that believing people in what they say. So whenever we talk of the HRD climate, without trust in the employees, it is never possible to create an HRD climate. Then we have autonomy. Autonomy means that we give freedom to let people work independently with full responsibility. There's a difference between openness and autonomy. Autonomy means that you are letting the people not be forced by, you know, follow a particular channel. Here, people are given the responsibility so that, you know, they learn to take risks and be responsible for whatever measures or whatever steps that they take. Proactivity is another factor of HRD climate. Proactive means that people are taking initiative to do certain tasks or certain work, so they are again not being dictated upon. They can take the initiative on their own to do something positive in the organization. Authenticity is the tendency to do what they say. So whatever people are saying or whatever they are claiming, they are actually trying to do it. And collaboration means that you work as a team. Together, we try to contribute to the development of the organization as a team. Now, let us have a look at the process of HRD. Now, this can be broadly divided into four distinct stages. We have assessment, we have design, implementation, and evaluation. In the assessment, we try to assess or identify the HRD needs. One of the most important stages, but neglected often, is identifying the area where improvement, if any, is required. Once we are able to identify those areas, we need to decide on the strategies to be adopted and prioritize them as to which one should come first and which one should come next, where the training should be first given. It depends on normally the criticality of the area and the return on investment that we can, you know, expect to have. Strategies can be related to developing the hard S, which is the structure, system and the strategy under the organizational development, or it can also be the individual development, enhancing their knowledge, skill, attitude and health. Individual development, this can be done through both training and non-training interventions. The question, therefore, that comes up is what do we mean by non-training intervention and how it can actually contribute to the development of human resources? The answer to this is that, you know, we can do this at the individual level and also at the group level through team building exercises at the group level and through job redesign at the individual level. However, we must keep in mind that any HR activity that we plan, this must be linked to the organizational objective. Rather, we may say that organizational objective will determine that what type of HRD interventions will be required. Say, for example, if an organization is planning to become the market leader. Now, in order to achieve this objective, the company may decide on the strategy of expanding its presence in the market. The manpower taken for managing this new market must then first go through an orientation program to acquaint themselves with the organization and the product. They may then be grouped with their experienced seniors to get on-the-job training as to how to make or meet their prospective buyers and how to talk about, you know, the important aspects of their product. So once they get to understand about what they are selling, then they can actually take over this responsibility and then develop. So after the HRD process, let's look at what we mean by the assessment of the HRD needs. Now, what we mean by need is that the concept of having a discrepancy or gap between what an organization expects to happen and what actually occurs. Now, all of us are aware of the concept of food chains when they are delivering pizza. Okay, I'm not taking the name on purpose, but you often find that they say if we fail to deliver within half an hour, then your entire amount will be refunded to you. Say we find that, you know, one day a person fails to supply within half an hour, within 30 minutes, we find that he has supplied it after, say, around 40 minutes or so. Now, the performance standard set is 30 minutes for delivering the customer's order. His actual time taken is 40 minutes. Now, we have got a gap of 10 minutes. The focus will be on correcting or finding out the reason for this substandard performance. We call it substandard because a target has been set and you have not been able to achieve that particular target. This need not necessarily be that the person does not have the skill to deliver. It can be when we analyze, we may find out that, you know, there are many other reasons why he failed to deliver on time. So if it is repetitive in nature, then we have a set of solutions. If it is something which has happened once in a while, then also we find that this is something which is an aberration, and it could have been, you know, a breakdown of his vehicle, or it could have been a traffic congregation which had actually started and traffic was not allowed in that area. So there can be, you know, so many reasons why there can be a discrepancy. Now, there are different types of needs. One is your performance deficiency. This is the gap that we have between the current and the effective performance. It can be a democratic need. I, as an individual worker, may want or may prefer a particular HRD program. It can be proactive in the sense, you know, we can divide this HRD need into proactive and analytic. Proactive means that certain factors and conditions are created and ensure that effective performance can be done. So what we mean by diagnostic is that before the problem has actually come into focus, we are trying to find out that, you know, how can we prevent occurrence of this problem rather than emphasize on an existing problem. So we are trying to prevent certain performance problem areas. And when it is analytic, then we are trying to find out proactively certain new and better ways to perform the tasks. These needs are generally discovered by intuition, by expert consideration, and then all. And then such training programs are done. And the third type and the last type of need that we have is basically compliance need. Compliance, this is mandatory by law by the government of India. So we have a number of mandatory training programs, for example, safety training. And these are compliance that any organization which has got a factory must follow. And if you do not follow such training programs, then there's a chance that, you know, you're likely to have all the NOCs that have been given by the government to be withdrawn. So let us now understand that what we mean by this needs assessment. As I've said, that assessment of HRD need is definitely very, very important, because it is this process by which we are able to identify that where lies the performance gap in the organization, and, you know, where, how much of gap is actually there in this. So the needs assessment, what they do is that they try to identify the organization's goals and effectiveness in reaching these goals, the discrepancies that they have between the employee's skills and the skills required for doing the current jobs effectively, the discrepancy or gap that the current skills have and the skills required to perform the job successfully in future, and conditions under which the HRD activities will occur. So all of them are actually taken care of. The purpose of HRD need is to provide an objective analysis. So whenever we are doing any needs assessment, it is very, very important that we do not become biased. We do not look at the locale where HRD initiative is being taken place and decide on my favorite employee to be sponsored there. It has to be very objective in the sense that this is what my organization requires. These are the employees who are expected to perform in this particular task. So we need to send them for their training and development. Often you find that employees who are actually delivering in the organization, managers are reluctant to release them. So they are not sent to any training program. Rather, those who are problem employees, in order to get rid of them from the organization for a period, they are being repeatedly sent to different training programs so that the work at the organizational level does not get hampered. So HRD, this needs assessment, they are the foundation for an effective HRD effort. It identifies that where and what kind of program or interventions are needed. It tells you who needs to be included in them and whether there are currently any problem in their effectiveness, and whether they can establish the criteria that can guide the entire evaluation process which is there. Now, there are basically two ways by which we can ascertain the HRD needs. One is done at the organizational level and the other one is done at the individual level. At the organizational level, the analysis that we follow is called the organizational analysis. And individual level, we have two-pronged identification area, which is related to task. The other one is related to the man. Now, the organization level, as you can understand, it's a macro analysis. So we have certain broad-based objectives of the organization, which is the basis for assessment of these HRD requirements. So it is basically for all categories of employees who are working in the organization. For example, if manufacturing organization goes for certain quality accreditation process, then all the employees of the organization are required to be trained in that, say ISO 9000, ISO 2000, 2010, whatever be it. So they have to be aware of what we mean by this quality accreditation that is there. So each and every employee, right from the managing director down to the sweeper in the organization, they must be aware of what the organization is going through and what is the role that each one of them has to play in this entire process. Individual level, on the other hand, is your micro analysis. Here we are identifying the knowledge, the skill required to perform the job. We are dividing them into the task and the man because one is very individual, person related. The other one is what knowledge and skill are required to do a particular job. Now, the needs assessment process, it shows that organization, when we are talking about in the organizational analysis, so we focus on where is training needed and in what conditions will the training be conducted. So the focus is on the climate of the organization, whether the organization actually encourages HRD efforts or it is something which the organization is simply asking the HR to do without giving the appropriate support. The task analysis, it is asking us that what must be done to perform a job effectively, and person tells us that who should be trained and what kind of training do they need. So the various reasons for which we can have, you know, productivity getting hampered or, you know, we need to give training is because certain basic skills are not there. Performance is not up to the mark. There has been a new technology, new product or a new job. Certain times we can have, you know, the customers have made a particular request to learn something new or to get a new aspects of, you know, a particular service that is being given, and higher setting up higher performance standards. So after we go through this analysis entire based on the organization task and individual, what we can expect is what the content that the trainees need to learn, who receives the training, that is the individuals who can receive the training, the frequency of the training, that is how often should a training be repeated, and the difference between the training and the non-training, that is whether we should go for training or, you know, certain aspects are there which can actually be taken care of by the non-training efforts that we are having. So this is the needs assessment process. Let us just go into the depth of, you know, the analysis of each one of them. The first one that we have is the organizational analysis. Now, organizational analysis, as I have said, that we are considering the context in which the training will occur. It involves determining the appropriateness of the training, considering the organization's business strategy, the resources that are available, and the support by the managers and the peers for the different training activities. It will actually help to better understand the characteristics that the organization has to determine that where exactly the training and HRD efforts are needed and what are the conditions under which these actually needs to be conducted or it needs to be delivered. Now, as you find that, you know, there are certain components that we have of the organizational needs analysis. So first of all, we are talking in terms of the organizational goal. Now, based on the short-term and the long-term objectives of the organization, we can actually have situations like, you know, the organization is planning for growth or diversification. It can think of automation, it can think of market expansion, or even they can think that, you know, we are not going to change, we are going to maintain the status quo, we are happy with whatever we have. Now, each of these stages, we find that we need to have training. Even when the organization is thinking of maintaining a status quo, we need to impart training so that the organization does not fall below whatever they are having right now. Now, organizations which are thinking, you know, in terms of having market expansion or diversification and all, there the budget and frequency of the training will definitely be much higher than companies which have no, planning any such major moves. So there it will be mainly focused on just continuing with whatever the organization has. You simply need to monitor the progress that the organization is going through. Now, opportunities, threats, and weaknesses that, you know, the organization goes through, because it can be that the government's industrial policy changes. It can be that you realize that the competitors are either gaining in strength or weakening. There may be certain restrictions on imports of raw material and technology. And you may have, you know, certain vintage machines, old machines. You can have absenteeism can be a major problem. Productivity may be a problem. Rate of wastage that happens in the production system can be very high. So there is a requirement to study that, you know, where lies the problem. So we need to actually match the short-term and the long-term goals of the organization with the current existing human skill that is present. There is also a need to get the support of the managers and the peers for the training activities. Now, it is a very, very critical aspect that I'm talking about. People need to be positive attitude about participation in the training activities, or willingness to provide information to the trainees about how they can be used, you know, more effectively, knowledge, attitude, and skills which are required in doing a particular job. And even the HRD climate should be conducive for developing and implementing the project. And if there are mistrust among the employees, then there would not be any type of cooperation in training. When we are talking about the training resources, then we can have talk in terms of the budget, the time, the expertise that is required for training. Say an organization proposes to go in for computerization for dealing with the major changes that they are having. Everything is going digital. Now, there can be three possible strategies for dealing with the need to have computer literate employees. One is that people who are already trained, they can actually come up and train all the other affected employees. It can also decide that it is more cost effective to identify the computer literate employees by, you know, making them go through a test. So those who do not qualify, they can be put in some other jobs. And we are rather than spending money on training, we want to, you know, take in people from outside and get the job. And in terms where we do not have the time or the expertise, then you can have the external consultants come up, and then they can actually take care of the change that is required. And lastly, we can have the environmental constraints. Environmental constraint means that these are certain issues which are not within the control of the organization. For example, there can be certain legal, social, political, or economic issues. For example, nowadays you find that the sexual harassment cases are very, very prominent in any organization. So in order to have equality of the gender, and in order to prevent any of the sexual harassment cases, it is important that there are training programs to make the employees aware of, you know, what constitutes an harassment, and make the employees be aware of you know, the major penalty that they are present in if, you know, somebody gets embroiled in such a controversial issues like the sexual harassments and all. Now, do we need to take a break now, or do we continue? Because I'm moving to a new topic, and I'd like to continue this without a break.
Ma'am, continue.
Okay. Okay, so the next aspect that we have is the individual level, that is both at the task analysis and the man analysis that are there. Now, first we must understand that what are those factors that actually affects employees' performance. Now, we keep on harping, you know, on somebody has not been able to do well or failing to do well. So the parameters that are there, that must be, you know, made very, very clear to the employees that this is what is influencing the employee performance. And if we can actually take care of these aspects, then there may not be any problem that we are having. So the first issue that we have here is the individual characteristic. Individual characteristic means that whether the employee has got the knowledge, ability, skill, attitude, the motivation to do the job. Now, knowledge and skill are easier trained than, you know, the attitude and the motivation. So sometimes you require self-motivation, sometimes you require motivation from outside. If you do not like to do a particular job or a task, then often you find that, you know, it becomes very, very difficult for you to get the motivation to do a particular job. And next, the input. This is what comes from the organization. These instructions must be very, very clear. They must tell you the what, how, and the when aspects of a job. You must be able to understand the need to perform. I'm given a job and I must know that why is it required. So when, you know, as a student, like right after my campus placement, I was got into the job from the campus to DCPL. And then my boss, who was the executive director, he comes and tells me that we had a subunit called, you know, DataQuest, which is an independent company now. So they used to do the jobs for the USA and all. They used to enter the data, and then they would actually ask them to deliver it, you know, the typing out. So what they were doing at that time was they were just typing out a telephone or something of that sort, if I remember correctly. And this management department where I was placed, there they were, you know, given a part of the job of, you know, checking whether there were any mistakes or not. Now, there were, you know, huge lots of printouts were given, and then they were asked to, I was, you know, we rather, management trainees were asked to cross check them. So you can realize, you know, what a blow it is to the ego. You do your MBA and then you join a consultancy organization with high hopes, and all of a sudden what you get to do is to, you know, check whether, you know, data entry has been correct or not. Now, unless you know that why you are doing a particular job, the motivation that you have, that you really do not get when you are doing it. So the necessary resources that are required in order to do a job, the equipment that is required, the time within which you must complete a particular job. So these are very, very essential. What my boss did was he asked me to sit across. He took up the job himself. He told me, keep the time. I looked at the watch. He said, after 10 minutes, you tell me. So after 10 minutes, I said, sir, time over. Then he told me that in 10 minutes, I could do 25 corrections. You are not as smart as I am. So I expect you to do 15. Now, when he is sitting right across the table and he is doing 25, and then he is telling me that it can be done, he's showing me that it can be done, then it is very difficult for an employee to question that, no, you are giving me a time which is not possible. He had actually taken into time that, you know, there will be fatigue and all and everything, and you know, 15, more than 15 cannot be done. Sometimes you can do 10, sometimes more, and as the time passes, there will be tiredness and, you know, it will go down. But the time that is required to do a job, it should be a very practical time that is given. It cannot be that, you know, you give a set a target for your employees and then you set a target which cannot be achieved. Now, many bosses say that if you give him a target of selling 10 items, he will end up selling 8. So if you give him a target of selling 15 items, then he will be able to sell at least 11. Now, it may be that even the person will strive harder in order to reach that higher level of targets that have been set, but we do not keep in mind that the fatigue that the employee is going to go through, the demotivation that he will have, because the percentage of his success rate is actually going down. If we keep those aspects in mind, then we should give them any of these targets that are being set. That has to be very realistic and very practical, that, you know, something that can be achieved. You must give the employee the happiness of being able to achieve certain targets that are there. And if an employee is able to surpass the target that has been set, he will very happily try to do it, because often you'll find that, you know, his increments are linked to the performance that he is giving. So it is not that, you know, people are by nature sloppy. People by nature will not try to give in their best. Next one is interference from other job demands. This is also, you know, very, very important, because it is not only one job that you do when you are working in the organization. So there are a number of jobs that you need to handle. Each of them have got their times that have been set, that within this particular time you need to do. So which one is a priority, that only the employee should be able to identify and then decide that, you know, how much of jobs can be done. In case, you know, two jobs are a priority of two different departments, it can also be. So it is better for the departmental heads to actually talk and sort out that, you know, which one is of more higher requirement. It is true that the employee has to do both the jobs, but you need to decide on, you know, which job should be given priority and which job can be given a little less priority. There are many jobs which are, you know, very repetitive in nature, which you need to do when you are working somewhere, but at the same time, it can be deferred for a while. Unfortunately, since, you know, jobs keep coming, once you get into the habit of procrastinating, or, you know, thinking that I'll do it later, then that later hardly ever comes by. Now, the next one is your output. So what is the job's performance standard that has been set? Now, when we talk about performance standard, it should not be qualitative, because what is good, what is exceptional, what is outstanding can vary with each of the person's own perception. So instead of keeping it, you know, open-ended to my determining whether I am an outstanding performer or, you know, a substandard one, let there be certain parameters which can tell you that you have been able to judge, or you will be able to judge your own performance. So every employee should know that, yes, I have been able to meet this target, hence I have actually come to a, I have achieved whatever has been set for me. So do not leave it, you know, to the subjective judgment, because whenever anything is subjective, there is a biasness which can actually come up, and then there may be a problem. And once a person has done his job, then there has to be certain consequences, be it in the form of an incentive. It can be a monetary incentive, it can be a non-monetary incentive. You know, often if people say you have done a good job in front of all your colleagues, that can be a greater incentive rather than, you know, you're just being given, you know, 1,000 rupees increment in your bank balance. So it matters, you know, what is more important to you. So if you are performing, then it has to be rewarded. It is not only about the amount that you get, it is a recognition that you get if you know you are performing well. And feedback is very, very important. If the supervisor is not giving frequent and specific feedback about the performance, but gives you a marking of, you know, B in while the performance appraisal is on, then you have got all the right to ask that, you know, where did I go wrong? So it is very, very important that the employee's performance should be given a feedback that this is where you are lagging. In between the year, if you are having an annual performance, then in between, it is always better to, for the supervisor and the employee to sit down together and decide that, you know, how he is progressing and where he is facing any problem. So if, you know, you do not look, since we have faculty members, so I like to say that if we do not tell a student that where exactly you are making a mistake, if they keep on giving submitting assignments to us and we keep on holding them, we do not check and tell them that this is where you are making a mistake, then what will happen is that we will, we cannot complain when they make the same mistake when we give such a question in the final examination. So feedback is very, very important, be it a student, be it an employee. Frequent and specific feedback must be given to the employee. And in such cases, you know, they have the ability to rectify that wherever there are any sort of errors that are there, they will be able to identify those errors, or they are being helped to identify those errors, and they can, you know, take measures to rectify, you know, wherever they are making a mistake. So once we are able to understand that, let us find out what we mean by this task analysis. Task analysis is basically the a number of small jobs that we find that they all together, they determine that what an employee should be taught, whatever he should learn so that his performance is up to the mark. So task analysis will help us to identify the standard of performance that is required, how we should do these tasks so that, you know, we meet the standards that have been set. And we also need to identify the knowledge, skill, and attitude that is required in order to meet the standards. So how do we do it? There are certain steps that are there in order to do this task analysis. First is, for any job that we do, we must develop the job description. What is a job description? Job description is a statement of the major activities that are involved in performing the job and conditions under which these activities are performed. So we must have an overall job description, and job description it actually is a part of our job analysis. So when we are doing the job analysis, then we get to know both the job description, which is the task, and the job specification, which is going to tell us the knowledge, skills, and attitudes that are required. So after we develop the job description, we must identify the major tasks. Now, what should be done is basically what we are trying to find out in the major tasks that are there. Now, how each of the tasks should be performed, that is, what are the performance standards that should be measured, and how these tasks are actually performed in day-to-day operation, that is, what is being done now. So the difference between what should be done and what is done is going to tell us that where do we find this particular gap in this entire process. So the method for identifying the major tasks are, you know, a number of methods are there which can actually be followed. So we need to just identify that the components of that major task, and then we can perform. We can also, job specification is going to give us the knowledge, skill, and all that are required in order to do the job. So the key task analysis is there, and we are going to identify those which are there, and also find out whether the individual has got those problems or not. Then we identify the areas that can benefit from training. We have already introduced the concept of non-training. So there are certain areas where you will find that, you know, training can make a difference, and in certain areas we find that training will not make any difference. Once we are able to identify the training areas, we need to prioritize the training needs. Now, prioritizing the training needs means that if you are getting 4 to 5 of the training that are required, then we actually need to find out that which particular aspect is required so that, you know, the training needs can actually be taken care of, and which is going to give us the maximum return. That is important. Okay, do not panic by looking at this task needs analysis flowchart. This is actually conceptually very easy to understand. Let me just explain. Now, whenever we find that an employee is asked to do a job, we must consider that employee can have strength in terms of knowledge, skill, and attitude, or he may have weakness in knowledge, skill, or attitude. So it's not that, you know, he will have a strength in all three or a weakness in all three. It can be, you know, he has got the strength in knowledge, but he is weak in skill or attitude. Okay, so that way also we can have a combination. Now, if an employee is weak in either knowledge, skill, or attitude, and it results in poor performance, then it is a sure shot need for training. So either the individual is lacking knowledge, or he is lacking in skill or in attitude. And the result of this lack in either knowledge, skill, or attitude is affecting his performance. So if his knowledge is less, then either he's not understanding the procedure of work, so he needs to be taught how to do the job. He may not be able to communicate properly. He may not be able to open up and ask questions. Lack of skill, it can be that he does not know how to operate the machines, or his wastage is increasing, so he does not know how to operate the machine that is there. And lack of attitude can be that he does not have the motivation, or he does not like to work in a team. So he can be trained in motivation, in teamwork, or he can be counseled. So this is a clear case of training being the solution to the problem that an individual has if he lacks in knowledge, skill, or attitude. On the other hand, if an employee is supposedly having strength in knowledge, skill, and attitude, yet we find that that employee is not being able to perform well. That is, in spite of having strength in knowledge, skill, and attitude, he is not being able to perform. then we need to study the reasons, because apparently at the individual level, he does not have any problem. He has no problem related to his own knowledge, skill and attitude, but something is there which is preventing him from becoming a good performer. Okay, so I'm not talking about the good performance, because it is expected that he will perform well because he has got the knowledge, skill and attitude. I am focusing on the poor performance part. Now, from the organizational point of view, the reasons can be that his objectives are not very clearly given. The job that he is asked to do is not properly designed. The job aids, that the tool or equipments that are given to him, are inadequate. The working conditions are not very good. Coordination is poor. Job is very monotonous, or his style of working is authoritarian. Now, that is not his style, that is his boss's style is very authoritarian. So you find here that, you know, all the reasons for which he has not been able to work has got nothing to do with the individual's knowledge, skill or attitude. All of them were reasons beyond his own control. This is where we bring in the concept of non-training solutions. We do not have to rush to give a training to an individual because he's not being able to perform well. We need to delve deep and find out why he is not being able to perform well. Only then we will be able to find the exact reason. Only then we can justify why we are doing a task needs analysis. And only then should we send him to a particular training program. In this case where, you know, we have the knowledge, skill and attitude, all of them are, you know, his strength, and again we repeat the entire training program and send him off to a training, then what is likely to happen is that the employee will feel demotivated, that, you know, I know everything, I have got the skill, I have been working on this, then why am I being, you know, again sent for a training program? Because it's not necessary that every employee will see it as a positive incentive. Some may, you know, consider that I'm a poor performer, that's why I'm being sent across for a training. So if you look at the solutions, you find that in order to overcome these problems which are there, we need to set certain time-bound objectives. We need to have a relook at the job that has been given to him, provide him with different job aids that are there instead of, you know, giving him a computer which is outdated, which is very slow. Try to provide him with a better computer, with a mouse which works, with a keypad which does not make an error. When you type B and G comes over, you know, such errors are not there. Try to improve the working condition. If people are all clustered together, they feel that it is claustrophobic, they cannot breathe properly also. So try to improve those working conditions which are actually there. Enforce accountability and discipline among the employees. If you feel that, you know, this person is finding the job monotonous, try to bring in job rotation, because the individual himself is not at fault. He may not like the job that is being given to him. So try to provide him with a job where he will give his best and the organization is going to benefit in the long run. And if the person is authoritarian, then it is always better to teach him to be more participative. Here, the leader needs to go through a training program and not the worker himself. So this is what exactly we mean by the task needs analysis, where the importance lies in this particular aspect, where the non-training aspects can actually be can take care of, you know, maximum of the problems that organizations face. And they can, if they're handled properly, then you'll find that, you know, a lot of the problems are actually solved. Instead of, you know, spending a lot of money on taking away a person from a job that he is doing, putting him in a training program, investing a lot of money there in trying to train him in a subject which he is already, you know, aware of, it is always better that you put him, try to identify that whether it is performance is not because he lacks in knowledge, skill or attitude, or it's the organization which is unable to provide him with all the requirements that are there. So we come to the man analysis. We have identified that, you know, the task for certain reasons people are unable to work. So we can find out certain non-training interventions and then do this particular job. But when we come to the individual analysis under, you know, the man analysis, then it is basically finding out that who needs training. It involves determining whether the performance deficiencies that are there, they are because, you know, there is a lack of knowledge, ability or skill, or it is work motivational, people does not have the interest to do the job. We need to identify the person who needs to go through this entire job and determine the employee's readiness for a job. And we also need to find out if a current performance or expected performance indicates a need for a job. So very simply, this is the process that we have. We have the individual's knowledge, attitude and skill. At each level, we try to find out the gap that is there between what one knows, what is required, what one possesses and what is expected, what one has and what is needed. So every area you find that, you know, there is a gap between the three, and this gap is actually helping us in identifying that where exactly the HRD need is there, and we can take care of those needs. So after we analyze, we look at the discrepancy. The desired performance minus the actual performance is going to give us the possible training need. So once we get a possible training need, we do not jump again to you know, sending the person off to training. We identify, we try to think, is this important? There is a possible training need. Yes, we agree. But what is the return on investment that we are going to get if we send him off to training? If you think that no, that it is not that important, then you ignore. If, on the other hand, you think that it is important, try to think, why is it important? What if we do not do anything about it? Is the cost of the discrepancy high enough that it seems, you know, worth pursuing this? If it is important, then is it a problem of skill? That is, I do not know how to do it, or is it a problem of will? I don't want to do it. Now, if I find out that it is a problem of skill, then definitely I go through a training. If it is again of will, then I can have either training or I can also go in for a non-training solution. Now, if that is a problem of will, I need to again think, is it because whatever job is being given to him, it was because of punishment? I had put him in a particular department as a punishment posting. If I remove that punishment, will the person be able to deliver again? Is it because, you know, non-performance has been rewarded, that even if he has, others have not performed as well as he has been, you know, equated with those who are non-performers? Is it the reason why he has become demotivated? And does performance matter at all? You know, whether I work or I do not work, at the end of the year, I'll get only one increment. So why should I work? You know, if others are also getting one increment without working and getting their whole salary, then where lies the motivation of my doing a job or working very hard and getting the same level of increment? If there is a skill deficiency, go for formal training. If there is a point of a will, then either go for behavioral or attitudinal training, or you can look for non-training solutions also by sending the person concerned through a job rotation to a different job setting. And whether you would like to send the person to a training or not, it will depend entirely on the return on investment. Because if you are sending a person for to a training, then you also need to analyze that what is the return that I'm going to get if I send this person to a training. So simply because we have got a solution called training, we cannot send people across, because when you send someone, there's a lot of cost involved. It includes the man hour that he is not contributing in the productivity of the organization, because we are taking a person out of his job and then we are sending him to the training. So it is always better to find out that what will be the investment, return on investment that I'm going to get if I send across this employee to the organization. Okay. Now, would you all like to take a 5-10 minutes break and then come back, or continue? Because we'll again be moving to a new topic. So if you want, you can take a break. Anyone, please, you may speak up.
Yes, ma'am, for 5 minutes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then we
Yes,
rejoin.
ma'am.
It's 4:30, so 4:40 we rejoin.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Mr. Kuswa, if you are there, you can stop the recording and restart after 10 minutes.
You can, because it will be defined again. No
Okay.
problem, ma'am. You
Okay.
can take a break. No problem.
Anyone has got any questions so far?
Yes, ma'am.
Any questions anybody has?
So, one question is from Dipanita Datta.
Yes.
Hello, ma'am. Yes, myself, Dipanita.
Dipanita, can you be a bit loud, please?
Yeah, yeah. Just a second, ma'am. Yeah, now I'm audible?
Yes.
Okay. Actually, ma'am, I was just wondering about one thing. That is, I mean, in what ways or how much this this age of new normal is affecting the HRD activities? Or is there any new affair or any new matter that the HRD is being concerned about? Or, you know, what would be that one issue, I mean, in your opinion, that HRD must look into or must be concerned about in this, you know, in this change scenario or in this change time? That is one thing.
Manita, I think, you know, this is a very pertinent question, you know, considering the time that we all are going through. But the role of HRD is very, very important right now. The major problem that organizations across the world are going through currently is that a lot of employees are losing their job. Now, what happens is that, you know, when you start losing jobs, when you see that, you know, the colleagues with whom you have been working, so they are no longer associated with you because, you know, their job is no more there, then you also go through a lot of psychological impact because you continuously feel that, am I the next one? Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, this is a time when HRD plays a major role in keeping the psyche of the employees, you know, cheerful, making the employees realize that, you know, why the management has to take such measures, and at the same time, you know, making them adaptive to the changes that are there. If you look around, you will find that people are wearing masks, that most of the cases masks are not covering their face. It is on their chin. Okay, now, this is not the reason why we wear masks. To educate the people, to make the people aware of the new changes that are there in the work process that is happening, so that, you know, we can avoid the contaminations and all that are there. That is also a training that the employees of the organization needs to go through. Very frankly, if, you know, we did not have this new normal, we would not have been present here on screen. We would all have been present facing each other, talking to each other. You know, just talking to a screen is actually very boring and demotivating. Unless you the faces of the, you know, persons to whom you are speaking, you really do not realize that. Yes. As a teacher, I don't know how much I've been able to convey. Okay, so I'm basically looking at my own PowerPoint presentation. So this changeover that we are having, that is also a need of HRD. We had to learn to get used to this technology. We at Alia University, we purchased a Google Classroom. We had a training program of, you know, training all the teachers how to use the Google Classroom, how to, you know, put in the names of each and every employee, how to connect with the students, how to evaluate using the Google Classroom. So that is also what HRD is doing. Okay, that is at the corporate level, we call it HRD. Here at the academic level, we do not label it as HRD. We simply say that, you know, it's a training that we are going through. So the role
mental
of
health,
HRD, yes, in any situation,
mental health of the, yeah, the employees or the person who are working is the most important thing to address right now.
Making people aware of, you know, what the changes are and how to cope with it is very important, because, you know, so many people are working from home. So even getting adjusted to this change of, you know, working from home, there are, you know, background, you find that so many people are talking for you to concentrate in this mayhem that is going on in your home. Your maid servant is yelling. You know, there's a lot of noise in the external environment. In the offices, you are sitting in a cubicled room, you know, you have air conditioners going on, cut off from the outside world, you know, glass ceiling is all around you. So you do not face that problem also. But, you know, to keep your entire concentration and in delivering, when you are not exactly in a work environment, that is also an adjustment that we are doing. Okay. So that is the role that normally you find that the HRD plays.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Any other questions? Okay. Then shall we restart? I think the screen is already visible, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
So let us now move to the individual development through training. This is from practical point of view, this is the most important part that we see. Because when we are talking in terms of, you know, identification of training needs and all, those are the work which goes on, you know, in the background. So people do not get to see much of the HR. It's only when we are implementing a training program, then people are able to see it. So just to recap that when we are identifying or going through the needs assessment process, we are identifying where the training or the HRD is required. We are identifying what kind of HRD is needed. We are trying to find out who needs to be trained and conditions under which the training will occur. So the needs that are identified also needs to be prioritized so that whichever aspect needs to get more attention and more resources, those are actually being given by the organization. So once we are designing the effective HRD program, the key activities that should be a part of this development of the training program are setting the training objectives based on the need that has been identified, selecting the trainer who is going to deliver the training, developing a lesson plan as to what should be the content of that particular training program, selecting the training methods and the techniques that must be adopted to deliver training, prepare the materials that are needed to deliver, schedule the entire program that is there, and design the training evaluation as to what should be the method that we should use so that, you know, the training program that has just been delivered is evaluated properly. So we need to keep these points in mind when we are developing the training program. The first step that we have here is setting down the objectives. Now, what we mean by setting objectives, and this is a very, very important aspect in designing a training program, is defining what the participants will be expect to learn as a result of participating in this particular HRD program. So the training program objective is going to tell us that what will be the desired result of the program. So we use the objectives in order to determine the method that one should use to achieve the specified outcome. We also decide on the program content. We use the objectives to evaluate the program's success, because vis-a-vis the objectives, we try to find out how much has been we have achieved. We also help the participants to focus their own attention and efforts during the program. So if we know that, you know, what exactly we are going to give, then you are also aware of what is to be expected from there. Now, training objective, as you can see from the definition given by Major, is there are basically three major components. One is the performance. So what is performance? It is a statement of what the employee is expected to do. Next is the criteria, that is the statement of the quality or the level of performance that is acceptable. And third one is conditions, which is the statement of the conditions under which the trainee is expected to perform the desired outcome. So, for example, when we are actually talking in terms of a customer service training program, now it can happen that, you know, often you find that in the malls and all where you go, that a particular customer is behaving very rudely with the salesperson. Now, in any retail sales customer service training program, these salesperson are actually trained to be able to express their concern to any irritated customers by very few words and apologize to them after they have stopped talking, and no matter how upset the customer is. So what we have here is that ability to express concern is the performance that the retail salesperson are expected to give. Condition is that he must allow the customer to settle down and, you know, talk his mind about how upset the customer is the condition. And the criteria is that he must start talking only after the customer has stopped talking himself. So we are not interrupting the customer. We are allowing the customer to speak in detail, and only then the retail salesperson is going to apologize and express his concern and speak in a, give his apology and tell him that, you know, what is to be done. So that is the performance that is expected from the retail salesperson. Now, the purpose and the objectives that we have expected outcome, it can differ with the type of training program that we are having. We are having, say, different types like the orientation training program. In any orientation training program, the basic knowledge and skill which is required for the efficient performance of a particular task is important. Here, the socialization process through induction training, it helps the employees to know more about himself, his aspirations, and helps him to settle down in the new environment. So the objective that we have of an orientation training program is the basic knowledge and skill required to work in the organization and to help the employee to settle down in the new environment. The refresher course, on the other hand, is to help the employees function more effectively by updating them with the latest concepts, information, techniques, and developing the skills required in their field of activity. So refresher that you are already aware of the knowledge and skill that is there. You are simply brushing up or updating your knowledge that you have had, or what we call as the de-rusting process, that the rust has already fallen. We are trying to remove that rust which was there. And the last one is your development, where we are preparing a second line of personnel so that they could occupy higher positions with more responsibilities as and when these arise in future. So to develop the competencies that we have among the employees in newer areas which are gaining importance, like, you know, innovativeness, creativity, the objectives must have relevance to the organization. Employees should know why they must attend a particular training program. Objectives can be for the overall training program and for each session of the training. Objectives can identify the type of training outcome that is expected to be measured in order to find out whether the training program was effective or not. Now, this is very important, because unless you know that what you are measuring, what is expected to be done unless we are able to identify this particular aspect, then we will not be able to say whether the training program has been effective or not, which is actually very important to find out. We can use the objectives again, as I've said, in order to find out that what should be the program content. So if I have a training program on orientation training program, then the program contents will vary. We are trying to use it to find out whether we have been successful in our objective or not. And again, we are finding out to decide that which methodology will be most pertinent when we are dealing with a particular type of training program. Now, when we design a training curricula or a lesson plan that we are having, we can, you know, consider that why. Okay, we can start with the why aspect, that why are we trying to deliver this training program? Is it that we are trying to prevent obsolescence? Is it that we are trying to equip the employees with newer knowledge, ability and skill for today and tomorrow? Then we can think about the whom, who are the participants, what is the number of people who we are targeting, what is the level of these employees, because depending on the employees, depending on the level of the participants, the trainer must decide on the area or the level at which he must try to impart this particular training. Then the next point that we have is what. That is, what is the training? Is it induction, awareness, behavioral, managerial? What type of training program are we giving? Then we have the where aspect, that is the venue. Is it an on-the-job training or off-the-job training, or whether it is within the company, it is an external training. So that determines your where part. How is the method, which we'll study a little later. Who is the faculty that who is going to come and deliver the training program? Because knowledge and skill required to design and implement a training program, whether he has got the expertise in delivering the training, communication skill is there or not, whether he's got a good interpersonal skill or not, whether he'll be able to motivate the entire team to learn. So these are all aspects which we must think of when we are deciding on the faculty. Duration is the total time that we have per day, per session. So the entire duration of the training program, how many sessions are we going to have, you know, per day, and what is the time per session? So say, for example, you know, you this particular training program that we all are going through, so we have a total number of days have been assigned. Per day you are having two sessions, morning and afternoon. Per session you are having, you know, 2.5 hours of session. So this way the entire training program has been designed. The training aids that are there, whether you require, you know, this recording facilities are required or not, you know, whether you'd like to share a movie, whether you need a PowerPoint presentation. So those are the training aids that are required. Course materials are whether you'd like to hand over certain course materials, like, you know, general or specific, or they are, you know, linked to the lecture that you'd like to give. Contents are, you know, the conceptual, practical, each of them, you know, can actually be dealt with. Infrastructure wise, where you are going to deliver, the size of the room, the ventilation, the light, the sound system, all of them are proper or not. And definitely we need to think of the budget. So these, all of them must, you know, be considered whenever we are talking in terms of delivering a particular training program. Now, when we design a curriculum or a lesson plan, so what a lesson plan? Lesson plan is, you know, more or less what, you know, everybody in academics is doing nowadays. You are planning a guide for, you know, a delivery. That what should be the contents that I'm going to deliver. I cannot, you know, keep on searching for words. I cannot keep on thinking about, you know, what all I should deliver during the course of the entire training program. So that is something, it is a guide. You can jot them down. You can think of it like the PPT is helping as a guide for the delivery. The importance of a lesson plan or a training curricula is that irrespective of whether the same trainer is there or not, you can have a repeat of the training program. So the method or the process of delivery may differ, but the content-wise, each and every participant who is going through a training program will be having the same type of materials or contents that are there. Now, when we have a lesson plan, we can decide on what will be the contents and the sequence of activity. Sequence of activity is very important because there has to be a logical flow in the entire sequence. I cannot start evaluating a training program unless I learn what is an HRD activity. From where do I start? From assessment of, you know, the HRD needs, and then only my last stage is evaluation. So if I jeopardize this entire sequence of activity, then I'm going to create chaos in the minds of the trainees who are there. Now, lesson plans are documented. They are not always kept in the mind of the trainer. They are written down, put in form so that, you know, the person who is going to use it can actually use this documented form later on to build up on it. It's a guideline that is there which can be helped. Now, do we actually design our training programs or do we buy them from the vendors? Now, if we are preparing a lesson plan, then we need to actually think that, you know, what is, whether who is actually preparing it. So the person who has got the expertise, only that person can, you know, consider designing a training curricula. So there you have to have the contents to be covered, the sequence of activities, the exercises or anything that you need to put in, the timing and planning of each activity, the selection of the methods that should be there in, you know, delivering, the evaluations that are there. But in case you think that no, we are not going to spend our time on, you know, developing a training program, we would rather go out and, you know, buy a training program from the vendor, then it has to be, you know, decided that if we, you know, do not have the internal expertise to design and implement the HRD program, then only, you know, we think of buying it. If we feel that, you know, the we would require lesser time to hire an outside agency rather than develop our own faculty members to deliver it, then also, you know, the trainers, sorry, to deliver it, then we can go in for, you know, outside vendor. If number of trainees is less, then it is better to more, you know, in-house training can be done if our number of participants is more. If it is less, you can always send people outside and do it. You can have to take into consideration the cost factor. Then it is definitely a very big say in deciding whether it should be internally designed or it should be bought from vendor. And if you think that, you know, that the subject is very sensitive, it is proprietary in nature, then it is always done in-house. If it is decision is to buy from the vendor, then we actually need to look for the proper vendor must be there. The product, the contents of the product and the organization's needs and objectives must match. And in certain cases, what is done is that there is a combination is also done where we are actually buying from an external vendor, but it is selected, it is, you know, made tailor-made for the organization. So that is also another aspect that is actually considered when it is done. Now, the factors, as I have said, that you know, it also one aspect which I have not covered is that the pace at which you know such a training program should go. So, depending on the level that we have, level of participants, the pace is also determined. If you think that the participants are at par with whatever you are teaching or you are conveying, then you can have a very fast pace. But if you think that you know you are dealing with people who are going to learn this for the first time, then you need to slow down and then talk slowly in covering, you know, whatever is being offered. Okay. So, once we have decided on the training curricula, then we move to the methods of training. Now, when we deal with the different methods of training, broadly we talk about on-the-job training and off-the-job training. So, we must decide that, you know, what is it that how are we going to classify the different training methods? So this is the requirement of the training program itself. That depending on the objective of the training program, we actually need to decide that what is the output that, you know, we are going to have. So we have we are classifying it into the on-the-job and off-the-job training programs. On-the-job is when, you know, people are actually working, they are learning. So both the things go hand in hand. That is called on-the-job training. And off-the-job training, when you are away from the job, you are having, you know, classroom training. That is called off-the-job training. Now, off-the-job training does not necessarily mean that you have to go outside the entire, you know, organizational, from the offices of the organization. You can have your training in the training room within the organization itself. Off-the-job means you are not working during that period. You are sitting in a classroom away from your work place and you are doing the job or you are learning certain thing, that is called the classroom methods. Now, we cannot really say that, you know, which is the most appropriate method for, you know, any type of learning. Now, certain it'll depend on, you know, the objective that we have. If we are trying to improve the interpersonal skills, then we can have role plays, we can, you know, adapt, you know, certain ways where the employee himself or herself is play acting. It depends a lot on, you know, if the monetary involvement that is there, that how much money will be involved in if we adopt a particular method. Say, even if we are recording an activity, that also involves, you know, so in a classroom scenario, often it is not possible to, you know, record and then replay. So those are, you know, aspects which are changing. Nowadays, you know, with mobile phone available, that can also be done, where the entire recording can be done and then replayed so that students can actually get to know that what exactly is done. So the we have a number of methods. Okay, there is we really cannot say that, you know, what are the different training methods. There are innumerable methods. So what we can actually do is just focus on a few of them. We are talking in terms of on-the-job training and off-the-job training programs. We also have a category called the self-paced training. Now, self-paced training is what we actually deal with, is the computer-based training. which are already available on the intranet of the organizations, employees are given a time, certain hours, certain days, and then they are asked to complete those training programs within those specified days that are given. And then they are also to go through a test to find out whether they have actually gone through that training program or not. This computer-based training or self-based training was done, is being done a lot by the in the IT sector now, where you find that, you know, most of the employees are staying, are doing work from home, and, you know, many projects are not taking off. So in such cases, what the HR is doing, that, you know, to keep them busy, to keep their knowledge and skill updated, they are providing them with such self-paced training so that the employees get busy, keep themselves busy, keep their knowledge and skill up to date. And then they are also given that time frame. It's a flexible time frame, but, you know, you have a total duration is given. So whether you do your training programs, say 5 hours a day, or whether you are doing, skipping one particular day and you're not logging in at all, is not a headache of the HR. At the end of, say, 36 hours, they would like to see whether you have completed one or two training programs that have been given to you, including the evaluation part. Okay, so this is something which is called self-paced. Self-paced means that at your own pace, you can train yourself. So under the on-the-job training, I repeat, what you are doing is that you are actually working while you are getting trained. So this is something like an apprenticeship training, where employees get to work on their work together along with the seniors side by side. The most popular one that we have is the job instruction training. Under the job instruction training, the trainers tell the workers that, you know, what is the total process that we have. We prepare the worker, put the trainees at ease. We tell them that, you know, this is what you, like, if the trainees have any questions, those are answered to. They are motivated to feel free and ask questions, and then the task is set up. Now, once you get to see the task, then they tell them what the task is. They explain each and every step that is there. They show it themselves, and then they demonstrate each of the steps involved in doing that particular piece of work. Now, the process that is there, you have to have the trainees perform the task. They are practicing. Have the trainees explain each of the tasks, because once they get into the job, the trainees should be able to do the job on their own. And the feedback is given on their performance by the trainers. They tell them where they are lacking or whether they are doing as per the requirement. If there are any problems that are there, then those problems are taken care of. And the last step is when they just monitor, try to find out how much the trainees can perform on his or her own independently. They try to encourage the entire questioning, check the performance periodically, try to find out how well they are doing. And gradually, they take themselves off from the training. So the employees who had joined in as someone who had no idea about what the job contains, now he has become a pro and he can independently work by himself. So this is what is called the JIT, or the job instruction training. Job rotation is a tool that is actually is a method that is part of both training as well as non-training. Under the job rotation means that we rotate an employee from one particular job to another. So he has a series of jobs in different functional areas for a period of time. So what the employee is doing, that he is moving from one department to the other, and learning the different skills that are, you know, required in different organizations. So he is going through a training in terms of learning and using new skills. It is a non-training method because when an employee is unable to perform in a particular job, he does not like to do a job, and if his position is changed to something different, then you find that he can find the motivation to perform well in that job where he has been changed, which is of his own choice. It brings in a variety in his career because he is getting trained in different aspects, and if there is any vacancy for promotion in that particular area, then he can be actually moved to that area as a career development tool. It can be used as a non-training method. It is always better to understand the different organizational functions which are there, because when a management trainee joins an organization, he's expected to learn that what the organization deals in, how the process of the organization work, and at each and every step he is expected to learn that, you know, how all the different departments work, and then he is placed in a particular department which matches with his background that is there. Job rotation helps in building the network that is there, and it also creates a lot of promotional opportunities for all the employees of the organization. The better you know the organization, better network that you can create, better it is for the employees to actually build a network and work together. Coaching is when you find that any employee is not performing up to the desirable behavior, then the trainer actually suggests certain performance improvement techniques so that his behavior changes. So this is an individual who has a problem is meeting with a senior who is helping in correcting the behavioral undesirable behaviors that an employee has got. Mentoring is a concept which involves a mentor who is a senior, an experienced person, and mentee or a junior who has joined an organization and who lacks the talents and skills required to do a job. So the mentor actually helps this junior to gain knowledge, to know the skills required to do a job. And while they are actually working, this they continue to learn. The mentor and the mentee, both of them, they continue to learn how to do the job. It is sometimes questioned as to what is it that the mentor gets, that, you know, that he is actually spending time with the mentee to develop his talents and skills. But it is always said that, you know, the mentor also learns while he's talking to the mentee, because the mentor, being a senior person, he may learn so many new skills that the mentee has because he's younger and he has experience he can have from a different organization also. He may learn newer methods also, and it definitely gives a motivation to the mentor that, you know, when he finds that his mentee is doing well in life. So that is also a motivational factor for the mentee. Under off the job training, as I've said, that, you know, there is no end to the different methods that we have got. The most common one is what we are doing now, that is the lecture. But the problem with the lecture is that it is one way, it lacks involvement, it appeals to only the person's hearing, and it becomes very difficult to understand whether the learner has learnt anything or not. We are doing this via an audio-visual technique, and that is also required. More or less, what we find in this audio-visual technique is that the it is not only that, you know, you simply switch on a system and then it plays. It is rarely used alone. It comes in conjunction with the lectures to show the real life experience. So we have a combination of both the lecture method along with the audio visual technique that is there. it is advantage of audiovisual technique is that you can repeat it. You know, often you can video, it allows you to come back to it as a number of times as you want, which cannot be done if you are not having an audiovisual technique. Role play is a technique, a method used, which is, you know, very popular in of the job training. Here in the role play method, each of the trainees are asked to give play the role of an individual. It can be that you have an interaction between, like I give the example of a retail salesperson and an irritated customer. Okay, so they can actually play out that role. In a role play, the dialogues are not given in advance. It is based on your interaction that you have with each other on the spot that you can actually get the different types of behavioral impact that are there when you play a particular role. It helps you in understanding the attitudes, the values, the behavior, and you can also discover the how one reacts under, you know, certain conditions. It is basically a time-taking method, but it does have its popularity and people enjoying doing the role plays in order to understand. Case analysis is a very, very popular method in management teaching. So a case means that, you know, a situation is given in writing mainly to the participants, and here they are expected to read, analyze, discuss, and take a decision on whatever the situation has been given to them. So it basically, the focus is on developing the analytical, judgmental, critical thinking, problem solving, decision making aspects of the individual who are there. Management games are the simulation techniques that are used for, you know, developing the management scheme. The difference with case analysis and management game is that in a management game, you are given the actual business decision making is done, and you need to give the entire solution to the problem from the business point of view. So we have decisions pertaining to marketing, finance, HR, production. So all the aspects are actually considered when in a management game. In basket exercise is a simulation exercise that we have. In basket exercise, what is normally done is that a set of information are given to an employee, and these are the correspondences that he is required to have from different employees who are there, and then he has to take a decision as to what needs to be done regarding this. It is called in basket because managers usually in the earlier days, they used to have two trays on their table. One was called the in tray, the other one was the out tray. So all the correspondences related to the manager's decisions were put in the in tray. That is, all incoming mail were put in the in tray. The manager had to take decisions on each of those correspondences which had come to his table, and then he used to put them in the out tray. The basic information, the basic concept behind this in-basket exercise is that you are given the background of an organization, you are given a particular role, and you are given a time frame. So within a time frame, say 1 hour, you are given a set of documents, and then you have to take decisions on each of those correspondences which are there and come to a conclusion or take a decision regarding it. The sensitivity training that we have is a T group training. I think you will be learning this in detail in your OD class. So this is an unstructured type of training that happens. This is basically trying to find out how participants perceive you. It is not how you behave, but it is how the other members of the particular group perceives you as, and how your behavior impacts them. Okay, how others react to this behavior and how they themselves react to others. So this is what is basically a part of sensitivity training. Knowing about how your behavior impacts others helps the employees to correct their behavioral pattern, you know, the how they should talk to others. That is actually taken care of. Sensitivity training focus is mainly on here and now. That is, I have to forget all about my outside. I forget about my official identity. I sit here as an individual and try to behave or talk to the members as and when it comes to me. Outbound training is a method which is being used often nowadays by the corporate sector. Outbound means outside the boundary of the organization. So in outbound training, mainly the employees are taken outside to a locale and they are given different types of group activities which focuses on, you know, group problem solving, team building. For example, they are asked to walk on the rope, they are asked to do rafting or mountaineering, or there are certain situations are created where they are, you know, simply let off and then they do not have any money and they have to find a way out to, you know, resolve their problem and come back to the camp. So such training, when people are put into difficulty, then you find that there is a bonding which takes place. Any one of them fails in the mountaineering or any aspect, then you find that the entire team will get affected. So the focus is mainly on problem solving and team building that we have in outbound training. Next, what we have is the management development program. This is very different from the training programs that we all were talking about. In management development programs, what we have is that we are trying to basically develop the managers, or we are trying to create the second line, as it has been referred to. So the objective is to improve the performance at, you know, all the levels. So we have to find out that who can be the next successor. We are trying to create that, doing the succession planning through the management development program. We also prevent obsolescence, because whatever be the level, there is bound to be obsolescence of your knowledge and skill. It helps in improving the analytical ability and the thought process of the employees, provide the opportunity to fulfill the career aspirations of them, understand if there are any problems of human relations and improve the human relations that are there. Now, management development problem that we have is, again, the process here is we identify the development needs, like we did the identification of the training need, of the HRD needs. From there, we try to appraise the present managerial talent of the employee. We have an inventory of the executive manpower that is present. And then we try to find out that, you know, which are the areas which are open where, you know, there is a focus on giving certain, developing where the people can actually be put in. And then from there, we are developing the development programs which needs to be implemented for those employees wherever there is any gap. And then we conduct the development programs, evaluate them. And this is what we normally do in this entire management development process. So let me just stop for a moment. And should we stop here today and then continue tomorrow?
As you wish, ma'am. Yes. They are tired now.
Yeah, I know.
It was very long and very impressive lesson, ma'am. It is Dr. Saroj Pandey. Hello, ma'am. And thank you so much. Even it is very inspiring message for me also, as I'm a teacher trainer. But even I'm thinking about that how long ma'am is taking without any interruption.
Actually, it was written that I must take 10 minutes break. That's why I took the break. Otherwise, I could have continued.
Yes, ma'am.
Because, you know, online, it is really more difficult to keep your concentration for so long. So,
yes, ma'am.
It does become very tiring. So that's the reason why I.
But ma'am, very.